new desktop. Let's talk about this. A few days back, we had a vlog on this channel where I gave you a quick update about things. I told you that my old computer broke down and I've replaced it with a brand new desktop. But I didn't go into too much detail about what this desktop was, what are the circumstances leading up to this point. So let's delve a little bit, further in detail as to what has been going on, what are some of the lessons I've learned, what are some of the expectations that I've learned to manage. So really, this is an opportunity for me to show off my new toy, but I'm going to try and make it vaguely educational so you can justify the ad revenue that you're going to give me. Well, that's a plan at least. More on this after the break. Hello and welcome back to another vlog. Now, in the past, you know that I have had this HP laptop. I have made multiple videos about it. It has been my main workhorse computer, right? It was powered with an i7 processor. You know, it actually had an NVIDIA graphics card, which is, the hallmarks of a fairly powerful computer. Of course, that was 6 years ago. At that point of time, it was, pretty powerful beast. And even until today, it still kind of is. Well, if it were working at least. That's why all my videos, all my work, were all done there. Right, from things like 3D graphics to video editing to, doing presentations and things like that. That was my main workhorse computer. Now, being a 6-year-old computer, of course, things are going to break down. In fact, I think there isn't a single working component on the entire computer. The headphones jack was completely ruined because, you put on your headphones, you plug it in and then you move around and it sort of tugs on the jack. Yeah, it doesn't, stand up to doing that over a very long period. So that stopped working. Many of my USB ports were quite loose. Some of them didn't provide enough power. So yeah, things like hard drives would only work with certain USB ports. My screen had these weird artifacts. If you squeeze on the screen, you see these vertical lines come out. The keyboard is broken as well. I did a vlog on that. Yeah, it's pretty broken. And I guess that's just a symptom of wear and tear over the years. I mean, like I said, it's 6 years old and I have been using it very, very regularly. So fast forward to a couple of weeks ago, it broke. The component that gave way was the hard drive, at least to the best of my understanding. And that shouldn't come as a surprise, right? As I mentioned in the other vlog, because I edit video and I do it so regularly, that hard drive goes through a lot of wear and tear. Videos are huge files and shuffling them back and forth is going to put strain on the hard drive. Multiply that by 6 years of constant active use, and yeah, this shouldn't be too surprising. I mentioned in the other video that I was seeing the warning signs for months, and that is true. Slowdowns have been happening, right? That is probably one of the earliest indicators that there could possibly be something wrong. Particularly, the slowdowns came from hard disk bottlenecks. So that means, the hard disk is having a bit of trouble finding things. Even though my hard disk wasn't that full, right, I tried to be disciplined enough to give it a few hundred gigs free at any point of time. So yeah, that was one indicator. It got worse and worse. Eventually, I started to see corrupted files, files that just wouldn't load. I had to restart my computer if I tried to open a particular file or folder. And then towards the very end, more and more things started to get corrupted. In fact, if you look back at one of the last episode of Friday Minis where I still had the second screen here, you would see that I didn't have my normal card showing there with the title. Instead, it just showed aesthetic image. The reason for that was because things got so corrupted that I couldn't open PowerPoint, which was what I normally used to put that card up there. So yeah, that was sort of the progression of things. Eventually, one day, I was just doing something. I tried to open a command window and it wouldn't open. Now, everything still felt smooth. Everything still felt like it was working. But anything I tried to open, be it a file or a program, just refused to do so. I have actually seen these symptoms before with another computer that I had in the past. So I was like, yeah, it's on its way out. I tried to restart it. It would not start. Interestingly, could still see that Windows was installed. It showed the Windows splash screen, but when it tried to actually load into Windows, it couldn't. It did a BSOD and then it boot looped and it wouldn't get out of that loop. So yeah, that was how my workhorse laptop kicked the bucket. That's it, right? And I wouldn't boot anymore. So yeah, I was kind of stranded. I still had another laptop. It's a convertible Dell laptop. It's still i7, but not all that powerful. So yeah, that sort of tided me through for a couple of weeks. So that's about the first half of the story, right? How we got to the point where I had to, well, go look for a new computer. Now, whenever, you know, there is a failure of some sort, the first question is always, so, did you lose any data? Now, the answer is mostly no. 99% of my stuff has been backed up. Every time I finish up a shoot, the videos go straight onto a portable hard drive, as well as, of course, a duplicate on my computer. All my work-related stuff, they're all in the cloud. They're either on Dropbox or OneDrive. And so every time I edit, things are being backed up live online. And what this means is all my most important things have been preserved. I actually practice what I preach. But it is the remaining 1% that will really come back and bite you. I suppose this would be the first lesson that is worth talking about. And that is, if you back up most of your things, it's the things you don't back up that, you know, will actually come back and hit you. And I'll give you some examples of what I mean. Now, you know how at the beginning and end of all my videos, I have these title cards, these end cards and things like that? Yeah, I didn't back those up. So, I tried to look through all my hard drives. I found very old versions that are, well, basically not the current ones anymore. So yeah, I was kind of stuck. In fact, for the few episodes of Friday Minis that have came out since then, some of which I edited on my laptop, I've actually had to go and download my videos from the channel and then cut down the proper card for me to use. And that's far from ideal, because if you have a transition, that eats into the actual card itself. And what that means is, if you've got to cut it out, right, you end up with a shorter card, which may or may not look and sound correct. So yeah, that's really unfortunate, but I don't really have much I can do about that, unfortunately. So yeah, whatever cards I can recreate, I will be attempting to recreate it. But for those that I can salvage, I will of course try and salvage them. So that's one fairly big thing, right? Even though you focus on backing up your main pieces of data, these sort of little things on the side that will help you as part of your workflow should also be backed up. And that was the mistake I made. I didn't do that. Secondly, and this one is maybe a little bit less of a big issue depending on, you know, what you do, is program configuration. Now, I configure things a lot. When I get a brand new browser, the first thing I do is I go into the options, tweak them up, then I install add-ons and tweak those. And you know, with browsers, there are all these secret configurations that, well, you go in and do. Now, I'm not sure if there's any easy mechanism to, you know, quickly back up everything, but regardless, I didn't do that, which means whatever programs I install, I am installing from scratch. However I wish to configure them, well, that's from scratch as well. So I may or may not have, you know, fully represented my old settings. The things I'm used to, you know, may or may not be there. And being a huge nerd that I am, I've also written some custom scripts, you know, some of which for the browser using GreaseMonkey, some of which are auto hotkey scripts, which just help with certain macros, you know, certain keystrokes and things like that. I was lucky that some of my auto hotkey stuff have been backed up by complete coincidence, so I could restore my most important ones. But unfortunately, I was not quite as lucky for the user scripts that were installed in my browser. I don't have those. I don't think I have any that, you know, really made a very big change. So luckily, but yeah, those were some of the things I've lost. So I guess the overall lesson when it comes to backing things up is that ideally, you would want to do a complete backup of every single little thing, because if you have it there, you've probably used it at a certain point of time. So yeah, a selective kind of backup may miss out on things that are really important to you, and you wouldn't notice until it's gone. So yeah, that's one thing I could potentially improve upon. Luckily for me, most major things were intact, so yeah, at least I'm able to get up and running again. Let's move on to the second half of this, right, where I talk about the actual new computer itself. Now, the specs of the computer are on screen. Right, this is a custom rig from a company called AFTERShocK. They operate mostly here in Singapore. And on their website, essentially, you can choose a, you know, semi-pre-built configuration and then modify it from there. So what you can do is you can go in, choose the processor, choose the RAM, choose the graphics card, and so on. And yeah, essentially for this rig, some of the major things I've chosen is the fastest processor they could carry for this particular model, more RAM, I have 16 gigs of RAM now, a fairly decent graphics card, I have an NVIDIA 1060, the 6GB version, and an SSD hard disk combo. So I do have a 256GB SSD on top of a 2TB hard disk. So yeah, that's supposed to give me the performance that would be good for video editing. As part of the package, I also got a Philips monitor, 23 inches, which is huge. Yeah, I've never actually had, you know, a screen that was this size before, so yeah, it's really nice to be able to, well, experience that. Yeah, it's a 1080p screen, so that means I can actually edit my videos at 1080p now. I also have the power to actually do that, so that's great. But yeah, I do want to talk a little bit about power while we're on that point, as well as managing expectations with regard to that. So from a pure numbers point of view, I definitely have a device that is much faster than what I had previously. And what I had hoped for was a great, great increase in, say, render times when I'm doing my videos. And my reasoning was as follows, right? I definitely have a faster processor with more cores, so that means it should be able to do the same amount of work in less time. I have more RAM, so that means general smoother performance. And I have an SSD. Now, one big thing about doing videos is that, like I said before, you're shuttling large amounts of data around. So having an SSD means you can move this data much, much faster. And what this means is your disk stops being a bottleneck. I've experienced this in the past with my previous computer that was, you know, just normal hard disk. And what you find is that when you're working with things on hard disk, usually your programs are stuck waiting for things to load. So that's what we call a bottleneck, right? The idea is that your processor is faster, your RAM is sufficient, it's just waiting for things to load from disk. So that was one big thing I wanted to work around. So I had a, you know, fairly decent SSD installed for that purpose. The graphics card would also help in hardware acceleration, again, for video editing, right? Because video editing is essentially playing around with images and your graphics card is pretty good at doing that really quickly. So yeah, with all this in mind, I did expect, you know, increased performance in video editing, and I didn't really get that for a couple of reasons. So yeah, let it be foreshadowing, keep that at the back of your mind while I sort of proceed along in chronological order. I put in the order for this computer, right, immediately after my old computer broke. Certain parts were out of stock, so it took a couple of weeks, I think it was about 2 weeks or so. They finally got everything in place, I got it delivered, and here we are. Brand new computer, Windows 10, and not a lot else installed. So I got to work installing the programs I use the most, right? Including my browser, my mail client, the various things I do for 3D and video and image editing. And this is a surprisingly complex process. Now, when I get a new Android phone, it takes a good 2 to 3 hours to personalize everything to the way I like it. And when it comes to a desktop, it's actually days. It's literally days. I'm not even done installing everything I need. So that's quite an interesting process because it's not trivial. What's interesting also is things like versioning. Now, previously I've been using Firefox. I've been a long-time Firefox user. And again, I've had a workflow set up, right? I have all the add-ons I need. I have everything in place. Now, the thing is, I was not on the latest version of Firefox. So when I came here and I installed the latest version, I found that some of the add-ons that I really liked and incorporated as part of my workflow were no longer working. They were just not supported with the latest version of Firefox. And the reason for this is because Mozilla has been making some big changes under the hood, and this has caused add-ons to break. This is true for both Firefox and Thunderbird, which is their mail client. So yeah, if you're on the latest version, you may find that some of your favorite add-ons from the past no longer function correctly. Some of these are restricted by just fake version checks, right? They just see that the version number mismatches and they don't let you run the add-on. You can hack around this, prevent that check from even happening, but you are still not guaranteed compatibility. So yeah, that's another thing worth getting used to, right? Of course, being in a new version is good because it's more secure, critical bugs are fixed, but your workflow, right, the things you are used to, may or may not be broken. So that's one thing you have to take note of. So anyway, I got through with the installation, right, put in everything that I use commonly. And then, well, of course, the next step is to actually stress test it, right? So yeah, I was playing around with a bit of Blender 3D, right? As you know, Blender is my preferred 3D software. I've been using it for many years now. So the render times were pretty good. Of course, they were much better than before. You could use a graphics card acceleration, which is of course great. Then I got to doing things that were a little bit more complex. I started doing things like smoke simulations, and then things slowed right back down. I don't know why I was expecting even complex things like smoke simulations to be very fast. That's obviously an unrealistic expectation. And yeah, my experience with, actually trying that out sort of knocked down those expectations a peg, which, well, to be fair, is entirely false expectations on my part. So yeah, that should have happened, and better sooner than later. Things are definitely not instantaneous, especially when you're dealing with more complex things like smoke simulations. It still takes, a good 10 or so seconds to render out frames. So I guess that's a more realistic number, and immediately after witnessing that, I think I got my expectations a little bit more in order. Now, the second thing I tried was video editing. I used, the software I've always been using, NCH VideoPad, and what I realized is that the render times were more or less the same as my old computer. Now, that one was the most disappointing of the lot, because I really expected a great increase in terms of render times. So I looked at the performance monitor and I realized that, it's just not using every available core. It's not fully maximizing resources. The processor couldn't be the bottleneck because it's not fully utilizing it. The RAM was definitely not the bottleneck because it was using just enough, I guess. The disk wasn't the bottleneck as well because, I could see that it wasn't being burdened. And what this means is that it has to be the program logic itself that is the bottleneck. The program wasn't doing things efficiently, it wasn't maximizing the resources that I gave it, and that's why the performance wasn't great, and that's not really something within my control. That one was particularly disappointing because what that meant was I couldn't use the software that I was so used to, that I've been using for such a long period of time. It's just not going to be that efficient. So what I did was I started hunting around to look for other programs, that were used for video editing in a more professional context. I found a couple. I've been playing around with HitFilm. That one I think I'm going to use mostly for effects if I do more effects stuff. I've also come across DaVinci Resolve, that is programmed by Blackmagic Design. Now, that has become free a couple of years ago, and it's a really powerful software, so I'm amazed they actually make it free. I have been using that to a fair amount of success. It does render faster, slightly faster than VideoPad, which is of course a good thing. And I can see it maximizing all my resources, which is great. Having said that, it's nowhere near as fast as it could be. And that shouldn't be too surprising because these software, they like to, do a lot of complex things. It's a pity because my editing is fairly basic and I'm using a program that is considered far too overpowered for this purpose. I will continue to experiment around with other pieces of software to see, what could be a good candidate that, balances its feature set with its speed. I'm still in the process of doing that. At present moment, at least I am getting, a fair amount of speed out of my computer when it comes to video editing. I can edit in 1080p now, which is nice. Previously, I've always stuck to 720p, despite the fact that, that's a resolution that's considered the bare minimum at present moment. But I've been doing that for a number of reasons. Firstly, because render times would become unbearable if I were to edit at 1080p. And secondly, you know how I do screen capture? All my previous screens were not 1080p. So there will be this weird disconnect in terms of the resolution, you know, as we move throughout the tutorial. So I kind of didn't want that, right? I wanted things to just stay at a baseline level. So yeah, now I have a rig capable of editing 1080p and a monitor I can capture off at 1080p. So moving forward, everything will go up to 1080p now. You can see my face in higher resolution if you want to do that. So yeah, hopefully that's a step in the right direction for this channel. Of course, I'm not trying to make this depressing, right? I don't want to sound depressing because I'm very much happy with, you know, how this rig performs. Especially for gaming, the gaming performance on this is definitely great. The 1060 is not the top card, you know, that is out there right now, but it has a pretty good balance in terms of its performance and its value, well, its price basically. So yeah, I'm happy. Many games I've been playing look absolutely gorgeous, so yeah, no complaints there. I guess to sum up this entire thing, right, I have been rambling for like a good half an hour already. A good conclusion for this, right, is that everything takes getting used to. The more time you put into setting up a rig and getting, well, basically familiarized with it, the more time you're gonna take sort of moving out of that habit into a new one. We can do things to make a new system, you know, look and feel like an old one, but there are always going to be these subtle changes that, well, are going to get in the way and you're going to have to get used to. Personally, I don't mind that, not in the least, because it represents a step in the right direction. And I'm sure that despite the couple of little setbacks that need to manage expectations at the beginning, I'm sure that I have not yet hit the full potential of this computer. I think nowhere near it. So over time, as I get more used to it, as I try and push its boundaries more and see how it reacts to that, well, I should be able to extract even more value out of this. I should mention at this point that I got this fairly cheap, right? It's about 2,000 Sing dollars, slightly less, which is very, very much worth it. That includes the monitor, by the way, but it does not include the speakers, the keyboard and the mouse, which I got separately for very cheap, so I'm not going to complain about that. But yeah, this overall is a fairly cheap rig, despite its fairly decent specs. So yeah, no complaints here. Yeah, this was definitely worth the money, and I look forward to being able to explore it further, getting used to it, and pushing the boundaries more. I have talked for about long enough at this point, so let's go ahead and wrap this up. This has been my new computer experience. It has been an interesting journey up to this point. I've had it for less than a week, you know, as of the time of filming this. So yeah, like I said, good long way to go, and hope to be able to do more. That's all there is for this particular episode. Apologies for the incessant rambling, but yeah, I'll let you go now. Thank you very much for watching, and until next time, you're watching 0612TV with NERDfirst.net. Thank you very much for watching. If you like my work and are feeling generous, you can shoot me a one-time donation on PayPal or sign up for a recurring one on Patreon. Of course, you can simply like, comment, and subscribe. You know the deal. For more videos, links to my channel and a related playlist are on screen. Thank you for your support.